Channel 4. Oregon won the first championship, but the sponsoring coaches association lost $2,500. So the NCAA gave new life to the event, moved it to Madison Square Garden, a showcase for legends. Coaches like Henry Iba of Oklahoma State and the Baron of the Bluegrass, Kentucky's Adolph Rupp. Immortal players such as the intimidating Bill Russell and Wilt the Stilt, who lost in triple overtime. Mr. Clutch from West Virginia and the Big O from Cincinnati. In time, the games themselves acquired a status as lofty and legendary as the players who performed in them.
He jumps, he passes out to Hunter, Hunter shoots, he off the rim, Brown gets a score, we won the ball game!
In the 60s, John Wooden, the Wizard of Westwood, built a dynasty at UCLA. His unprecedented 10 championships in 12 years set a standard of excellence and drew national attention to the sport. In the wake of Wooden, other personalities moved in and out of the limelight. Superstars strutted their skills in a series of memorable matchups that captured the fans' imagination. The Final Four continued to grow and now is one of the premier events in sports, the culmination of March Madness, our newest rite of spring. Today, we'll highlight a half century of treasured memories and take a nostalgic look at the growth of this grand American pageant. CBS Sports proudly presents 50 Years at the Final Four. Live, Kemper Arena in Kansas City. And good afternoon, everybody. I'm Jim Nance. Welcome to 50 Years at the Final Four. In the next half hour, we're going to celebrate the first 50 years of this championship. You know, going to Kansas City has been the catchphrase for college basketball fans all season long, and today they're finally here. Again, we're going to take a look back at all the fabulous memories and also take a look at what shapes up as one of the most exciting and unpredictable Final Fours this year, the 50th edition. For more on that, let's take you right now inside to my co-host, James Brown. James?
All right, Jim, thank you very much. Inside Kemper Arena, excitement and enthusiasm is building noticeably, and as you can hear by the playing of this Kansas University band behind me, they're anxious for the first game between Duke and Kansas to get underway, and of course the second game will be Arizona and Oklahoma. Now, on today's program, we'll take a look at a trend towards high scoring. We'll also talk with some of the game's greatest legends. We'll relive some of the most memorable upsets in championship history, and we'll kick off our retrospective with a look at some of the finest coaches ever to stalk the sidelines when 50 years of the Final Four continues here on CBS.
50 Years at the Final Four, a CBS Sports Special, is sponsored by Mercedes-Benz, engineered like no other car in the world.
Welcome back to 50 Years at the Final Four. I'm sitting in one of the four hot spots in this arena, the coach's chair. Now, interestingly, one of the hottest rumors in the coaching circles all this week concerned Jim Valvano of North Carolina State, who reportedly was to become the new head coach at UCLA. Now, sources suggest strongly that will not be the case. And those same sources say there will be an announcement later on today that there will be no deal. CBS spoke with Jim Valvano earlier, and he had no comment. Now let's move to today. Three of the head coaches in today's game have been to the Final Four before, Mike Krzyzewski, Larry Brown, and Lute Olson, but yet they haven't captured their first national crown. It is indeed a very precious prize, and only a select circle of coaches have ever claimed more than one crown, and they are indeed college basketball's Elite Eight. There are many ways to define a legend. One of them is through championship performance. In 49 years of Final Four history, only these five collegiate coaches have won the NCAA basketball championship twice. One notch above them is Bob Knight of Indiana, who last April won his third NCAA title to cap off America's Year of the Hoosiers. Knight is a notorious perfectionist whose 1976 squad went undefeated. 5 years later, the prodigious 19-year-old Isaiah Thomas fulfilled his coach's prophecies. And the third title was truly charmed, a testament to Knight's coaching abilities.
He wants to play that perfect basketball game. He would love to win 100-0. And I think that's one of his greatest traits, that he's always trying to perfect his coaching ability and his team's ability to perform on the basketball floor.
Mike's coaching genius sometimes manifests itself in seemingly curious ways. He is, if nothing else, a man of intensity, driven to get the most out of his players.
If you get on a player for making a mistake, now, only one of two things can happen. Either he makes the same mistake again, you got to get him out of there, or he realizes, and he improves. And when he improves, you just say, now that's the way to do it all the time.
He was known as the Baron of the Bluegrass, Adolph Rupp. He won a pair of championships in the 1940s and another two in the 50s. The Fabulous Five won the NCAA title in 1948, and a decade later, Rupp was back with the Fiddlin' Five, playing the same tune.
Coach Rupp was a bright, articulate person, a hard-working, hard-thinking, and I think he outworked the other coaches, and he certainly outworked the players.
Rupp was a student of Dr. James Naismith at Kansas and a teacher at Kentucky for 41 years without a losing season.
He was light years ahead of the rest of college basketball coaches in his particular time.
The coaching legend who loomed larger than life during the first five decades of the NCAA tournament is John Wooden of UCLA. With his ability to attract star centers and surround them with a strong supporting cast, Wooden created a Bruin dynasty. More than just a coach, Wooden was a special man who developed a close relationship with his players.
We loved being around him every day. It was one of his key tenets was to always make it fun. Basketball was never drudgery.
He didn't get excited. It wasn't a whole lot of histrionics. I really appreciated that because I thought he was always in control and knew what he wanted us to try to accomplish.
Wooden's first and fondest championship was in 1964. Ironically, he did it without a dominating center, right here in Kansas City. Jim Nance has more.
This is Kansas City's Municipal Auditorium. Back before the Kemper Arena was built, this was the site of the city's nine previous Final Fours. But this week, Municipal Auditorium has been transformed into a museum, showcasing the teams, the players, and the coaches spanning the first five decades of the Final Four. The 60s and 70s belonged to the UCLA Bruins, and this man, Coach John Wooden. It was in this building in 1964 that Coach Wooden won the first of 10 NCAA titles. And it's our privilege to have with us today the Wizard of Westwood, Coach John Wooden. Coach, 1964, your first NCAA championship right here in this building. What memories are evoked on your return here?
Jim, that was my first championship, and I'd say the first championship is much like the first child. It is very, very special. And the fact that we had the shortest team to ever win the championship with no one over 6'5", and went through undefeated, it does bring back very pleasant memories.
You know, after 1966, that's really from 64 on, the only year you did not visit the Final Four. How did you motivate your team every year to get back to the promised land?
You can't live in the past, and I tried to make this clear to them that nothing will ever change the past, whether it was good or bad. And the only possible way that can have any effect on the future is what they do every day, right now, and that'll be gone in a hurry. So I tried to motivate them that way and not let them rest on their laurels in any sense.
Coach, as we stepped into the 70s, the dominance of UCLA continued, and then you retired in 1975. There's no better way to go out than another championship for John Wooden.
I think most people would agree with that, Jim. Yes, it's nice to finish one's career on top, so to speak. And this 1975 team was a delight in many ways. They gave me no problem on or off the floor. And I think as a team, they played about as close to their level of competency as any team I ever had.
Coach, it's a delight to speak with you as we all celebrate the first 50 years of the Final Four. Thanks for the memories.
Thank you, Jim. You're very kind.
Of course, when a Bruin team won a national championship, it came as no surprise. But when we come back, we'll take a look at some of the Cinderellas that walked away with a national championship.
They once told me I'd never make the team, but I proved them wrong. They said our team couldn't win the conference, but we did. The experts didn't give us a chance in the tournament, but we made it to the Final Four. Then, we had nothing to lose, and we won it all.
Down to 7 seconds. You see the time. Whitford, oh, it's a long way. They won it! A
at Kemper Arena in Kansas City for the 50th Final Four. The stars of the previous Final Fours have been honored all week. There's Jerry Lucas. He was two-time MVP in the Final Four. Jerry West's West Virginia team lost in the finals to Cal back in 1959. And Oscar Robertson appeared in two Final Fours as well, all here to see the Final Four in 1988. You know, there's really something about the Final Four that brings the best out in individual players and not necessarily just the superstars. As a result, sometimes when you least expect it, a championship game turns into a surprising drama, and a mere basketball contest is elevated into the realm of theater. Such was the case back in 1957, when undefeated North Carolina played underdog to number one Kansas. It was perhaps the greatest college basketball game ever played.
Wilt the Stilt Chamberlain was a sophomore at Kansas. His overwhelming physical gifts made him the dominant player and his team the top-ranked squad in America. Undaunted, number two North Carolina simply tried harder.
We were a team of destiny, and there was no doubt in our minds that we were going to win the game.
The Tar Heels were a collection of New York City playground stars who traveled by way of Frank McGuire's famous Underground Railroad. Through three grueling overtimes, it all came down to one play.
All right, it's taken out by Parker. Parker throws a long one into the left side. They feed it into Stilt, and it's tapped away from Stilt into the hands of Kearns, and we win! 54-53, North Carolina did it!
That upset victory seemed to trigger a rash of surprises. Cal Berkeley stunned West Virginia, Ohio State bested Berkeley, and Cincinnati in turn shot down Ohio State. But just as the Bearcats were becoming studs, along came Loyola of Chicago to fashion one of the most famous of all upsets. Trailing by 15 points with only 12 minutes to play, the Ramblers took control of the game as Cincinnati went on a wildness streak, giving away turnover after precious turnover.
When we came together, we fit so well. It was like a puzzle, different parts fitting in. That's what made us.
9-8. Harkness has got it. Here he goes. He jumps. He passes out to Hunter. Hunter shoots. He off the rim. Brown gets it. Scores. It's over. It's over. We won. We won. We won the ball game.
In 1966, Texas Western, now known as the University of Texas at El Paso, staged one of the most sociologically important upsets in sports history. The Miners were the first all-black team to reach the Final Four. By contrast, Ruff's Runts, as this litter of Wildcats was called, sent out five white starters.
Kentucky, they were a lot like us. They all played together and they were smaller. But I think we were just a little too strong for them up front.
While Don Haskins' team flexed its muscles up front, Kentucky, unaccustomed to losing a championship game, found it heartbreaking and embarrassing.
We're number one is the Big Yell from Texas Western. The ball game is over. Has lost the championship game for the first time in their history.
Nightmare. That's what it was. We, believe it or not, were flat the night of the ultimate game against Texas Western because we had assumed we won it the night before against Duke, and we paid dearly for that.
North Carolina State was ready. Lorenzo Charles was camped under the basket and had the presence of mind to send home Derek Wittenberg's desperation toss.
It was magic. It really was. When the ball went up and Lorenzo dunked it, it really took all of us a couple seconds to realize that the game was over, that we had won the national championship.
And then Villanova pulled off basketball's perfect game. Mighty Georgetown and Patrick Ewing were poised for a second straight crown, but long shot Villanova pulled off the American dream.
The underdogs, lights, cameras, Georgetown, Villanova. Perfect shooting, Villanova championship.
It comes inbounds, and that's it. It's 66-64. Villanova upsets the Hoyas of Georgetown, and Villanova wins the NCAA championship.
And carrying the banner for Kansas University today is another big man by the name of Danny Manning, 6 feet 11 inches tall, multifaceted, multi-skilled player who pretty much single-handedly has brought the Jayhawks to the Final Four. And going back in time now with the architect of perhaps the greatest upset in championship history, with me is Mr. Frank McGuire, formerly of North Carolina. is the memory of that upset win over Kansas and Wilt Chamberlain just as sweet today as it was then?
Oh, much sweeter now, because we can see the result of what actually took place then. We were the missionaries who started all this big hullabaloo. This is a great, great spectacle.
You had mentioned to me there were some special things you did in preparation for that game. What were they?
Well, when we put our smallest man against to play the biggest man in the world, actually, Wilt Chamberlain, the best basketball player. And I thought psychologically that would help us.
All right, and there are a couple of other coaches who are hoping psychologically they can pull off upsets here in the Final Four. And we'll have more on 50 years at the Final Four right after this.
Tournament and the Kansas University campus less than an hour away. Tickets have really been hard to come by. Well, CBS Sports reporter Leslie Visser has some thoughts on the significance of this special occasion and how it relates to this year's quartet of semifinalists.
Well, Jim, we started with 64 teams and we're finally down to four. Each one of these teams has its own special link to the tournament's past. Ironically, the phenomenal success of the Final Four has all but ensured that the event will be held in gigantic indoor stadiums, usually those with the Suffolk Dome at the end. But this special milestone deserves special treatment, and even though Kemper Arena doesn't seat as many fans as, say, the King Dome, this is truly a homecoming for the NCAA. This is the heartland of America, Kansas City. The land lays flat here, and the grain rises high. 40 miles up the road, Dr. James Naismith settled down, a number of years after his game of tossing balls into peach baskets caught on. Perhaps it's fitting that we return home to the heartland for this celebration of a uniquely American sport. Of course, with time and change, even Dr. Naismith might have trouble recognizing his game. 20 times this season, Oklahoma scored more than 100 points, a far cry from the Sooners' last trip to the Final Four. Back in 1947, they lost to Holy Cross, 58-47. Still, Naismith would have been pleased to see two Big Eight teams in the Final Four. In addition to Oklahoma, Kansas is making its eighth appearance. And all week long, Danny Manning's been hearing how the Jayhawks marched to their only title in 1952, led by Clyde Lavelle's 33 points. What Danny probably hasn't heard is that the legendary Big Clyde got lost in a fog the night before the game. He couldn't find his way home, he didn't get any sleep, and he barely made the tip-off. You can be sure Danny Manning will be here on time. Duke is no stranger to this event. Back in the 60s, the Blue Devils made it a habit, with teams that were high-scoring on the court and in the classroom. With four starters on the Dean's list, the Blue Devils dominated the college boards even before they arrived on campus. Out west, Arizona blazed its way to the big shootout for the first time. And folks are wondering, who are these guys? No one from the Pac-10 had reached the Final Four since UCLA in 1980. Ironically, Arizona is led by a group of transplanted Californians, and one of Tucson's own who stayed home to give the local fans a moment in the sun. When all is said and tallied, Oklahoma, Kansas, and Duke have been to a combined total of 14 Final Fours. Yet only one has emerged as champion. And they all know how elusive that golden moment can be.
Saying goodbye to a car you've owned for years is a lot like saying goodbye to an old friend. But if it's a Mercedes-Benz, there's always this cheering fact to consider. Over the years, Mercedes-Benz automobiles as a line have retained a higher percentage of their original value than any other make of car sold in America. And that can make the sorrow of parting a little sweeter.
Excuse me, are you the Milton Fitz?
You found him.
Terrific. You're called Washington's official barber because you shave everyone from senators to cabinet members.
Just take a look at that wall, son.
Milton, what do you shave these powerful men with, huh?
A Bic shaver.
Bic? Not your barber's razor?
That's history. Bic is the best darn shaver I've ever used.
Okay, now who's that getting shaved with Bic?
Just look for the best shaved senator on the next debate.
The Bic shaver. If it's good enough for Milton, it's good enough for you.
To help celebrate the 50th anniversary of the Final Four, a big dinner was held Thursday night in Kansas City, and a lot of the legends came back to recall some of the great memories, including Howard Hobson, the coach of the first national champions. Bobby Knight was there. Bill Russell, two national championships for San Francisco. Jack Gibbons. And even Jim Valvano was in town on Thursday night. A big special dinner here in Kansas City. And what a week it's been. And now the honorees are about to be introduced to the crowd here at Kemper Arena. And it's been a fantastic week. Leslie, what are some of the memories that have been brought back to you this week as we honor some of the special participants?
Well, Jim, Bill Russell, a man not given to great emotion, said it was one of the most special moments he ever experienced.
James?
Johnny Wooden, as great as he is, as highly visible as he is, he never used the word I when he talked about success. It was always we and my players.
Well, it was terrific, I thought, seeing Howard Hobson, 85 years old. He was the coach at Oregon when they won the first national championship back in 1939. He was on hand, as well as Henry Iva. And there's Mr. Hobson. You know, moments from now, the 50th Final Four will get underway right here in Kansas City, and the torch will be passed to a new generation of players. As they take to the court, they become, in essence, the living link between college basketball's glorious past and its seemingly unlimited future.
And so, before we turn it over to the capable hands of Brent Musburger and Billy Packer, we'd like to conclude our Golden Anniversary retrospective with a special salute to the many headliners who have helped propel this sport into the magnificent spectacle we enjoy today.
"50 Years at the Final Four," a CBS Sports special, has been sponsored by Mercedes-Benz.
Please rest between the pages of my mind. Memories sweeten through the ages just like wine. Quiet thoughts come floating down and settle softly to the ground like gold of autumn leaves around my feet. I touch them and they burst apart with sweet memories. Sweet memories. Memories press between the pages of my mind. Through the ages, just like wine. Memories sweeten through the ages, just like wine.
Afternoon, playing the game of his life. The Hawks fall their way into the Stockyards and the Final Four at Kemper Arena.
We're going to the Final Four, baby.
One time, baby.
Anything your heart desires.
Here's an inside play to Talbert. He goes up. The shot goes in.
We're going to Kansas City. We're number one. We're going all the way. King behind the defense for a jam.
The Sinners know that they are going to the big city. After 3 weeks, the road to the Final Four has reached its destination. Here in the City of Fountains, where hope springs eternal. And where college basketball fans can't wait to unleash their emotions as their heroes strive for a national championship. To basketball's greatest show. Four teams playing out the American dream. And in Kansas City, which has hosted more collegiate championship games than any other city. In our opener, it is that long shot out of the Midwest region, the Kansas Jayhawks against the champions of the East, the Duke Blue Devils. And then in the second game, Arizona, the team which dominated the West, playing Oklahoma, a team with two speeds, fast and faster. This is one of the most anticipated days in American sports.
Rhea again to Kemper Arena in Kansas City for today's national semifinal between the Kansas Jayhawks and the Duke Blue Devils. Now, let's meet the starting lineup. For Kansas, at a forward, a 6'4 junior from Washington, D.C., number 21, Milt Newton. For Duke, at forward, a 6'6 senior from Sterling, Virginia, number 55, Billy King. For Kansas, at forward, a 6'8 senior from Lawrence, Kansas, number 24, Chris Piper. For Duke, at forward, a 6'10 junior from Bowie, Maryland, number 35, Danny Ferry. For Kansas, at center, a 6'10 senior from Lawrence, Kansas, number 25, Danny Manning. For Duke, at center, a 6'5 sophomore from Fayetteville, North Carolina, number 21, Robert Rickey. For Kansas, at guard, a 6'3 sophomore from Tulsa, Oklahoma, number 14, Kevin Pritchard. For Duke, at guard, junior from Mercer Island, Washington, number 14, Quinn Snyder. For Kansas, at guard, a 6'5 sophomore from Charleston, Illinois, number 33, Jeff Geldner. And for Duke, at guard, a 6'5 senior from Mount Airy, North Carolina, number 31, Kevin Strickland. And introducing the head coaches, for Kansas in his fifth season, Larry Brown. And for Duke in his eighth season, Mike Krzyzewski.
6 weeks ago, these two teams played in Lawrence, Kansas. In overtime, Duke won it 74-70. Back with the rematch in just a moment. City, the Kansas Jayhawks were able to avoid Purdue, Pittsburgh, and North Carolina State in the Midwest region. As for Duke, their road through the East Regional was a little more difficult. They had to beat the top seed, Temple, by 10 points to get to the Final Four. The referee today, and he's a good one, Booker Turner from Los Angeles, California. He will work alongside the two umpires, Jim Burr and Larry Limbo. Kansas in their road uniforms, Duke the higher seeded team. They will wear the home whites, but the crowd very pro-Kansas. The university down in Lawrence is only about 45 minutes away from the Kemper. Danny Manning's first shot partially blocked, and Duke controls the ball.
Tough man to man, and it looks like it's going to be Bricky on Ferry early on. A tough matchup for Bricky because Ferry's got about 5 inches on him, Brent. Watch him see the next time down the floor. If we don't see Danny Manning moving down inside on Bricky, He's using that height advantage.
Bricky, 21, did not practice much yesterday. We'll develop that story for you. Here's their point man, Quinn Snyder, underneath the basket. Ferry misses his first shot, and Pritchard, the point man for Larry Brown, brings it across the timeline quickly for Kansas.
Nice job by Piper on Ferry that time. And there's Manning going down inside on Bricky.
So the turnover.
See Danny going down inside. He realized Bricky's on him, so instead of going out into the perimeter area, he's sitting right down inside looking for the pass. He didn't have a good angle on that one.
Snyder with pressure from Pritchard. Both tough man-to-man defensive teams here. And the game's first foul is called, and it goes against Geldner, number 33 of the Jayhawks.
Obviously, Geldner is playing Strickland to shoot the jumper. Strickland wisely went by him with the dribble.
I mentioned Bricky's problem yesterday. He had an allergic reaction to a penicillin shot. So he was quite ill, unable to hold food, but he reported before the game that he slept quite well and should be able to play today. That is Piper stepping into the lane, making the interception, forcing the turnover for the Jayhawks.
Get Bricky on his hip.
Newton, the role player, number 21, introduced from Washington, D.C., but he actually grew up in the Virgin Islands, played for their national team.
Great cross.
And a pass to Piper and the defense inside. Strickland was there along with Bricky, and the first foul goes against Duke.
And Brent, you see how fundamentally sound Danny Manning is when he made that changeover right off the pass. Not many big people can do that. As a matter of fact, not many guards can make that play.
So that first personal was against King. One apiece here in the foul category, and already Coach Krzyzewski is up in front of that Duke bench. He knows he's in a somewhat hostile environment. It was unusual yesterday in that when Duke came out for their shoot-around to be introduced, they were booed.
And Brent, it was interesting in that shoot-around, there were more people in here that actually attended the national championship in Kansas City in 1964. Man, full court, a lot of pressure, really extending the defense out.
Strickland moving it to King. Ferry bottled up, so he comes out to seek the ball. Tries to get Bricky and Manning with a good defensive play for the Jayhawks.
I think Duke figures with the defense out that far, they can get something down low.
And Newton hits the first 3 points.
Against Billy King, something that Macon couldn't do all last weekend.
Kansas defense now forcing mistakes on the part of Duke. Geldner. To the hands of Pritchard with a jump pass in. Low off the glass. Danny Manning is there. And it's a quick 7-point burst here by the Jayhawks.
In the first game that these two teams played this year, Kansas got a big lead on Duke early on also. Mike Krzyzewski's going down inside because he wants to pick up some foul trouble on the interior. But so far, Kansas has really overplayed that passing lane.
Scooter Berry checks in. He is the first sub off Larry Brown's bench. He played a sensational game last Sunday against Kansas State in that regional final. Strickland. And Duke still not on the board as Pritchard runs it down now. It's 3-on-2. Newton off the fake. Great defensive play there by King. Ferry. Short.
Not close.
Long rebound run down by Pritchard.
And Brent, when you're down like this early in the game, you're wanting to get a better shot than that.
Manning wanted it, and Ferry picks up his first personal foul. Billy Danny Manning is bigger than anyone Duke has out on the floor right now.
That's a very tough matchup for Duke. See, they started off with Bricky on Manning. Great position play by Manning there to hold Ferry off. But Bricky is a little small for him, and Mike Krzyzewski does not want to use Danny Ferry on him early because he doesn't want to pick up the foul problem. Smith into the ball game now, which is a little better matchup size-wise, and of course he's coming off that broken hand.
Arthroscopic surgery, not expected to play. He was out shooting 6 hours after the surgery. Manning's shot is short. Snyder, the point man for the Blue Devils. Into that lane was Manning. But he gets it into Henderson's hands, who had checked into the lineup. Now for Duke.
Time for Duke to get in their offense. Kansas overplaying every pass. Opportunity to set some screens. And you notice Kansas doesn't let the passer get an open area at all.
Berry's still off. And it's Manning who can put it down, trying to get the ball into Berry's hands. Back to Newton. Tap by Manning.
Mike Krzyzewski going to the timeout. They're getting away from him.
And early, 9-point explosion by Kansas. Kansas record, the poorest of the four teams here, only 25-11. Larry Brown lost 6 Jayhawks since the start of the season. He has used 12 different starting lineups, yet he has been able to retool and bring this team here, playing in front of a very partisan crowd in the Final Four, 16-20 to go, and he has broken ahead of Duke 9-0. Danny Ferry 0-for-3 at the start of the game.
Good switch that time by Manning.
Henderson, Pritchard rebounds. Duke can't buy a bucket early.
Teams really extending the defense out. I think Manning can get a shot on the inside if Duke's going to play that far out.
Now it is Smith eyeing Manning, and Newton's three is there. That's his second three-point shot.
And Brent, Kansas had Duke down in the first game, 23-8. Duke can't get a basket.
And the foul. Pritchard reaching in on Snyder. And Mike Krzyzewski will go back to his bench. And he will return Strickland to the lineup. And he will try Ala Abdelnaby for the first time. They will check in. Now, Abdelnaby gives him a little more height underneath. He goes at 6'10". He's a sophomore from Bloomfield, New Jersey. It is obvious against Manning, who is playing with enormous intensity. And please remember that he fouled out the last time these teams met in the Final Four in Dallas. Scored but 4 points. He has come back to be the player of the year. And as Billy Packer told you before the game, he reminds one all of Larry Bird and what he did. Another turnover forced. Then it was Manning with a hand on it. Newton goes for two.
Defensive intensity is taking this game right away from Duke. Brent, they can't get an easy shot inside. No rebound.
Abdelnaby tries the hook, and he finally puts Duke on the scoreboard. We have played almost 5 minutes. He hit that at 15-11, and so it is 14-2 Kansas.
A lot of time, obviously, in this ball game, and you get a lead like this, and the momentum Kansas got going. They got, I would think at this point, get the ball down to Danny Manning and make Duke work against him the rest of the way.
Now Duke forces the turnover, and they can put together field goals here for the first time. Here's Quinn Snyder with his three off the iron, and out comes Newton for Kansas.
Oh, how about
Manning
moving? Sensational play by Danny Manning, breaking out of the pack. He realized that Newton had the rebound. He took off. Duke had bad floor balance. And then Strickland complicates everything by fouling on this play. You might as well let a player like Manning put it in there. No chance to block that dunk. Just heads-up play by Danny Manning. Proving he can do about everything. Running on the break and filling that lane.
Who grew up in Greensboro, North Carolina, moved to Lawrence, Kansas when he was a senior. And his father, Ed Manning, took an assistant's job alongside Larry Brown, and the two have stayed side by side for 4 years. Danny Manning says it's been bittersweet having his father, Ed Manning, alongside of him like that. He said there are times when he's been too critical, but when the times are good, it's awfully nice having Dad alongside of you. And he sits down for a couple of words from his coach.
I think a nice move here by Larry Brown. He's got the lead. He's got an opportunity to rest Danny Manning and keep him out of foul trouble, which is one of the keys in his first half.
Jumping out is Piper, and he fouls Ferry. That is three team fouls on Kansas, three already on Duke. Manning quickly Barkley checks back into the game.
That wasn't the strategy I thought was involved in that substitution at all. I thought he let Danny rest for a couple of minutes.
Mike Krzyzewski has beaten Larry Brown three straight times. Only three times the schools have met. It's going to be that type tougher the way things are going here.
Danny Manning, he knows it was his fault. You see him patting himself on the chest. He said, that was my fault. Committed himself by going up in the air. Mike Krzyzewski really upset with his ball club in terms of the way they're trying to pass the ball. But give a lot of credit to this Kansas defense. They've extended the perimeter to the point that Duke just doesn't have any passing lanes.
King, Henderson, Strickland, Abdelnaby, and Ferry try to get it going right now for Krzyzewski. Newton out on King. Ferry, but there was a whistle. And the foul will go against Newton. That's the fourth team foul.
Probably a good foul by Newton, though, Brent, because Duke had the numbers down on the inside. Ferry could have had a layup.
Quinn Snyder, the point man, returning for Krzyzewski. Manning, already with 7 points in the game, has exceeded his total in that semifinal a couple years ago in Dallas. King off a fake, had his pocket picked on the inside.
Boy, Piper doing a great job defensively. He hadn't scored yet, but boy, he is doing everything inside.
Ferry comes flashing through the lane and draws the foul.
That's twice that Danny Manning has not converted on a fast break situation, trying to make too big a play.
In, Strickland comes over from the weak side to help out defensively. Touched by Duke. So the ball go back across the timeline. Knocked out of bounds with Strickland reaching in. Hit last by Gelder, and the ball will go over. So we've got a break on the floor here in Kansas City. 9 minutes to go in the first half. Standing proud in the heart of the great Midwest, Kansas City, Missouri. And here their Jayhawks have exploded, holding the Blue Devils scoreless for the first 5 minutes. And they have out-rebounded Duke 12-5. Now, Billy, what must Duke do here to get back in this game?
Well, the first thing I think they should remind themselves that they were basically down this far at Kansas. What they have not done is gotten into their offense at all, and the reason for that is the great Kansas defense, particularly on the outside. So they've got to get back in an offensive structure, and I think set some screens from the backside.
Kubek's three-point shot is on the money. The three will help get you back, too, won't it?
If you're Kansas, I think you want to get the ball to Danny Manning every time down the floor and really put pressure on Duke's defense.
Ricky is fronting him. Manning roaming along the back. You can watch him there. There's number 21 jumping out in front. That is Ricky. Manning going back deep to the baseline. He powers over Ricky. Great pass on the inside, but Barry could not do anything with it.
Good cut without the ball by Scooter Barry. And the reason for that is anytime Manning's got the ball, you have two men on him.
Harris returning. And sitting down is Chris Piper.
That hurts the Kansas defense a little bit because he has been excellent down in low.
Strickland on the run was left free as he got into the heart of the key.
And that's where they missed Piper, because he would have been down in there for a potential block.
Normore returning for Kansas. And Barry sits.
Now Larry Brown really has to look for a ball handler.
It's always got Manning.
Yeah, that's true.
His way for that ball.
Oh, great shot.
He just wanted it more than Snyder did.
He proved in the Pan Am games he's a scorer. Leading scorer for the Virgin Islands. And Brent, Newton's only getting to play 22 minutes a game. His second leading scorer on his team getting 11.
King drops it off on the inside.
Nice pass to Strickland that time, who has scored 6 points here in the first half.
Football player in the Final Four, huh?
Larry was shorthanded, so he had to get a couple of football players to come out just to allow him to scrimmage during the week. And Newton.
He's eaten up Billy King.
He is 5 of 7, and that Billy could be the unknown Jayhawk here this afternoon.
Kansas has extended Duke's offense. They're out 30 feet to get it started.
Snyder bangs his first field goal.
Larry Brown trying to get some rest for Pritchett out here. Risky Duke, gamble.
And Duke trying to end the first half on a positive note, if it can. Puts it down, gets inside, out to Olave, and hits a runner.
When he's got the big guys, Brent, he goes outside. When he has the small guys, he goes inside, can put it on the floor. Very gifted player.
It's hard to find anybody in the college game who can stop him one-on-one. Perry coming up. He was fouled, and that's 2 on Gilman. And that's 7. They are over the limit. So they'll be shooting 1-1. Team fouls against Duke, so they still have one to give here at the 3:41 mark. But Kansas leading Duke, 30
remaining part of this half.
If you just joined us, it was an early explosion by Coach Brown's Jayhawk team here. And the defense triggered it. Their first 6 points coming off turnovers.
As you mentioned, this young man, the ACC's Player of the Year. Over J.R. Reed. And back again next year.
So we've got a television timeout here at the 3:41 mark. It's 34-23, Kansas over Duke.
Ever since your post office invented express mail overnight delivery, others have tried to copy our eagle. But it's not so easy.
Of the Kansas defense.
Well, it has been sensational in the NCAA tournament. Defense is your constant. Brendan, you can see what Kansas has done throughout the course of this tournament. Just sensational, holding teams way below their average. Not quite as good today, but I think what's interesting, although defense is the constant, how about the variable?
Exactly. Larry Brown today has shot 64%. Jayhawks hitting their last 5, and they've held Duke to 47%. Henderson with a hand on the ball, knocking it away, and Berry returns for Kansas.
I wonder if Mike Krzyzewski is thinking now maybe to show a little zone before the half ends, just to throw Kansas off and give them something to think about.
Philly, coming into this game, the experts said that Duke was the deeper team, but here in the first half, Larry Brown has rotated as many players as Mike Krzyzewski, both using 9.
He has, I think, a real testimony to his outstanding coaching and ability to work with kids, because they are not that talented.
There's Harris, knocked away by Bricky, gets it back.
Probably shouldn't have shot that shot.
Manning attempts to save it, but he stepped out of bounds. The ball goes over to the blue line.
Harris has to think about shot selection a little bit. With this kind of lead and this kind of time, you want to make sure Danny Manning gets a chance to touch the ball.
Strickland. Sealed up on the inside, maintains possession.
Good hand check by Pritchett.
Perry trying to trade off the dribble. And they tie it up, but they maintain possession.
Now players have to realize how referees are refereeing a game. So far defensively in the man-to-man, the refs are allowing a little hand checking on the perimeter.
Bricky has it knocked free and out of bounds.
Not good defense, but has to be frustrating when a man gets that ball with a slap from behind, because Bricky had a clear path to the basket.
Kevin. loses control.
And again, great Kansas defense. Duke just doesn't have any free passing lanes, and they're a little frustrated. That was their opportunity to get it down below 10.
Play. 15 points for Manning here in the first half.
Really impressed with Pritchard's defense out front. Turnover, not called.
Bricky. And just ball. Manning gets it into Newton's hand. Inside of 2 minutes here in the first half. And Bricky fouled by Manning, and what a difference from 2 years ago. That is the first personal foul called on Danny Manning in this game.
Well, that's what Larry Brown told us yesterday, Brent. He wanted to make sure in the first half Danny Manning had no more than one foul, even if it meant that he wouldn't be quite as intense on defense as normally. He has been intense and has stayed out of foul trouble. And I would credit that to the great perimeter defense by the Kansas guards, because nobody's been able to get an easy pass inside.
Taken away by Kansas.
Wait on the big guy. There he is.
It is, and he jumped the pass off beautifully that time. And coming in is Newton, who has scored 14 points for the Jayhawks in the first half.
Duke is all thumbs on that one.
9 Duke turnovers here in the first half.
Well-drilled club. Now, are they going to let Danny Manning handle it? Get either a shot or a good pass. Kubek is 0 for 2 in catches.
Snyder runs it down in the corner. Inside to Bricky, a slick pass by Ferry, who is one of the better passing big men in the game.
Larry Brown wants one shot here. Good move on his part. Don't know if I've seen a better defensive first half by a club in a long time. Ferry switches over to guard Manning. Down to 24.
Newton foul. That's the sixth foul against Duke, as several subs again check into the game. Abdul Nabi returning. Kubek sits down, and so does Bricky.
Cook in the ball game for the first time.
Well, it's been the Manning and Newton show so far. They have scored 29 out of Kansas 38 points. Henderson also off Coach K's bench. And again, Larry Brown substituting right along with Krzyzewski, returning Gellner and Mike Maddox. We've used 10 men. And it goes over with 14 seconds left in the first half.
But that was a big turnover for Kansas, because they didn't need to try to get the ball down inside at that occasion. You've got yourself a nice 13-point lead, working on 15. Brown takes Manning out so that he doesn't pick up that cheap foul with 14 seconds.
Billy, how good a three-point shooting team is Duke?
Well, Henderson's a good three-point shooter. Kubek can shoot it from out there, so can Snyder. Good drive.
Snyder hits the layup. And the first half comes to an end. As far as the Jayhawks are concerned, well, as Dorothy would say, it's great to be going home. They explode to a 24-6 lead. They were up by as many as 18. They go to the locker room leading by 11. The end of the first half, and our coverage of the NCAA basketball championship on CBS continues after this message and a word from your local station.
Piper and, of course, Newt.
And Duke comes back down with Snyder over to Bricky, who traveled. trying to get the ball into Strickland's hands. Ferry is out there along with King.
And that's a decision that Strickland would have been smart to go ahead and keep that ball, not put it in Bricky's hands on the wing. He wants to be a finisher, not a guy that has to make the pass.
Richard out on top for the Jayhawks. Piper pops to the ball. They wanted Manning and King, who had dropped down low to help out defensively.
Shows you some smarts on King's part, because he was tied up with Newton and realized the ball was going into Manning and slid over there.
Sloppy start to the second half so far. Newton looking for its rhythm. Perry short on the three. And it was Strickland who pulled it away from Geldner. Into the hands of Snyder now, with Pritchard all over it. And the first foul goes against Kansas here, and that's Pritchard's second.
There's the hand checking by Pritchard all the way across the lane on Snyder. Now that is something that Duke has to adjust to. When you feel those guys with their hands on you when you got that ball, you've got to slap them away and draw that to the attention of a referee.
Quickly, Berry replaces Gilton here in the second half.
Brent, I think the key thing for Duke is to try to get into some offensive flow in the second half. You know, they took Kansas took them out of their offense completely in the first half. If Mike suggests he has to do anything, he's got to get his team back into a half-court offensive pattern in their passing game.
The big difference between this Duke team and the one 2 years ago that played in Dallas, the lack of senior leadership. This basically is a very young Duke team, with the exception of Strickland and King. Pritchard gets all the way inside on a penetrating move, his first field goal of the afternoon.
But he had a sensational first half without scoring. Did not turn the ball over, had five rebounds, just ran the game beautifully.
Very short jump shot out there, yanked away by Piper.
Pritchard seeing the court beautifully.
Manning wanted the jump pass, wound up in the hands of Ferry. That's 10 Kansas turnovers here in this game. King wants it back in Ferry's hands. Off the dribble.
Ferry's not shooting well, and the reason for that, Piper's doing a great job on him defensively.
Newton won't stay, and Ferry yanks away the rebound. Three on two, and again that Kansas defense.
Nope. Off King's leg, great steal from behind.
Mike better be careful, he's going to swallow his gum over there on the
good
side, trying to get back in this.
Good piece of officiating there. Both teams a little sluggish here to start this second half. They can't get the ball back into the offensive flow the way they had it, at least not in Kansas' case, because they played very well offensively in the first half.
Ferry is only 2 of 10 in this game, though. He's missed his last 5.
Brent, I haven't seen anybody take Billy King to the cleaners quite like this. Sean Elliott got 31 against him, but you know what he is as far as an All-American caliber player. Newton is just taking it right to King. Snyder jammed a finger.
Henderson will replace Snyder. Abdelnaby also into the game for Duke.
Sure, Coach K is saying to Snyder, you don't need the ball down on the baseline with guys like Piper and Manning shutting you off.
King into the paint. No fall. Newton couldn't get the handle on it. Blocked by Manning. Lead to Pritchard. Normore's open on the other side. Pritchard keeps it. And Strickland comes out for Duke.
No flow by Duke in his game.
Offensive foul against King.
Brent, I have not seen this club get in a fast break situation when the wrong man handles the ball so often on the break. They have not converted at all, even when they had the numbers. Kansas ought to go to Danny Manning this time down the floor. Take a little time off the clock, make sure the big guy touches it.
Yeah. Pritchard, the open man is Piper. Henderson to Ferry, and again Manning blocks the shot. Piper gets it into Pritchard's hands. There he is. Manny Manning with two more, his first of the second half, and 17 for the game. And Krzyzewski uses a timeout. Connection in this game. Duke's Mike Krzyzewski played for Bob Knight when Knight was the head coach at West Point. Then he served as an assistant coach under Knight at Indiana, and Bob there in the blue sweater and the Duke button watching intently as his former player and assistant coach has fallen behind 44-28 with 16-16 to go, as Kansas has played just an outstanding game here this afternoon, especially on defense.
Piper moving those feet, just cutting everything off for Ferry.
Now it's Strickland's three and four, and here comes Norrmore now into the hands of Pritchard. Back they go. Pritchard not there, but Manning trying to clean up. He does. That's 19 points for the big fella.
Brett, you see that in a Final Four and in the NCAA tournament, as they get down to the pressure games, teams tend to crack, and you look for where those cracks are. That was the first one I've seen from Duke, taking a very bad shot. We're starting to panic with his score this high right now. And it's going to cost them.
Ferry gets it back to Strickland. King hounding Norrmore, who's handling the ball here, as Pritchard has moved to the off guard. He has played both of those spots this season. Coach Brown. Manning. Offensive foul. His second.
Good fake by Abdelnaby, because Manning had him set up for almost a clear-out one-on-one move.
Father watching intently. You know, Ed Manning and Bob Ferry, Danny's father, were teammates back with the Baltimore Bullets. And when they were toddlers, the two youngsters used to play in the locker room.
And, of course, Ed Manning played for Larry Brown when he was with the Carolina Cougars. So there's a long connection here.
Great connection with the family. Danny Manning and Danny Ferry have been friends since they were knee-high to a wastebasket. They used to stuff the ball inside the Bullets locker room. Great fake by Snyder. Basket is good. Score the field goal, says Limbo.
Ferry trying to get position. Good follow-through by Quinn Snyder on that shot.
And the third personal against Ferry.
Well, Mike Krzyzewski cannot be thinking about personal fouls right now. He's going to have to leave him on the floor, even with three.
Trailing 46-32.
Man with the ball right now has been the key to Kansas' great play the second half of the season since he moved to the point guard.
Berkey.
That Manning was waiting on him, and again Duke not making good decisions on the break. Here you see Bricky committed way on. There's Danny Manning waiting on him. I thought that was a charge all the way.
Three fouls on Manning at the 14:37 mark.
Now watch this. Danny Manning's waiting. I think he was there. And again, all Bricky had to do was to move out to the side, get the ball back to the center, and they had a three-on-one break easy.
Duke at the free throw line is only 5 of 10 here for Krzyzewski.
Notice how Danny Manning's coming back to help them bring the ball up the court.
Ferry wanting more pressure applied. And Larry Brown will use a timeout. It's 46-33, Kansas leading Duke by 13 with 14:28 to go. Here with Kansas up by 13, there's a lot of heat on the two point guards. Quinn Snyder struggling today with one assist and three turnovers. The surprise in this game has been Kevin Pritchard. Now, he was born in Bloomington, Indiana. He was a blue chip prospect out of Tulsa, Oklahoma. His parents book entertainment acts now, including the Oak Ridge Boys, and he's making some pretty music here for the Kansas Jayhawks this afternoon. This is Newton. To the line.
What was so great about that is Billy King tried to go rushing out at him to take away that jump shot, and Newton, who has been sensational today, just calmed. Now watch this. You'll see Billy King go right out at him, try to stop the jumper. He makes the great move, gets King out of position, goes up, gets hit on the arm, and still has the follow-through to score. Brent, this guy had 32 against Brazil in the Pan Am Games. And you remember Brazil, Pan Am Games, the United States? Not bad, huh? He redshirted 1 year at Kansas and is coming on strong today. This best game he's played, although he had 19 in the second half against Oklahoma.
Perry glides the baseline.
Manning careful there not to pick up another foul. Just know he wants to stay out on the court right now.
Manning off the dribble.
Good shot.
Three on two. Bricky saves it, and then it's knocked out of bounds.
Brent, I bet you if you go back and look at this game, you see how few times Duke has been able to convert on that fast break.
At the conclusion of this tournament game, Billy, you and I will select the Chevrolet players of the game from each team as Quinn Snyder misses on the field goal. Newton off with a rebound, and there's Pritchard coming down off the dribble. Lob inside to Manning. Misfiring again. Wound up in the hands of Bricky.
Danny Manning's getting a little tired right now. May need a blow because he doesn't miss those kind of shots often.
Bricky thought Manning was right behind him. Missed on the fake, and Perry hit it on the follower.
I think Larry Brown's going to have to give Manning a rest. Whether he does it by slowing the game down a little bit or whether he takes them out, Manning's tired right now.
Still 12:50 to go here in the second half. Duke gets it on the turnover. Snyder pressures it out of control. Bricky taps up. Offensive rebound again for the Blue Devils. That was Kubek hustling for it. Strickland bluffs the three, and here's Bricky off the dribble. And again, a block inside. Couldn't get it to fall, and it's Ferry, and he is fouled this time. That is the second on Newton.
Larry Brown going down at bench. He's got a tired team on the floor right now. They've given tremendous effort on defense. Bricky goes inside. Piper comes over to help, as he did really set the stage early on. Bricky can't score. Ferry puts it up, gets hammered. You've got to be able to convert those on the inside. I cannot get over Duke on the fast break today. They've had so many chances to convert and have not been able to do so.
There is Manny, Billy, taking the break you spoke about.
Well, Larry Brown is a great, great coach. Final Four, you think of the 80s, he's been here three times, Brent. Two different teams he's taken to the Final Four. Only eight coaches in the history of the game have done that. And surprisingly, two of them are here.
Lou Holtz in the second. We'll see him in the next game against Oklahoma.
Now, what Kansas cannot afford to do here is start looking at that clock. There's a lot of time to play. Duke's making a big run on him.
Abdelnaby returning here at the Kemper Arena in Kansas City with Billy Packer. I'm Brent Musburger. 12:23 to go. Duke fell behind, giving up the first 14 points in the game. And now it is down to 10. 49-39, but it has been all uphill this afternoon in this national semifinal for the Blue Devils. But they are on a 10-3 run right now over the last 3 minutes.
Open offense here, looking for some backdoor cuts.
If Duke fans taking heart in the fact that Danny Manning is not on the floor right now. Knocked away from Pritchard, and it'll go over to the Blue Devils. That's turnover number 14 by the Jayhawks.
Larry Brown's got a thought here, Brent. When you get down under 10, that's kind of like a magical number to get down into single digits. Manning comes right back in the game, only sat down for about 30 seconds. Kind of like how long you want your starting pitcher to stay in that game.
Strickland, who has been handled here this afternoon. Kubek explodes, and there is Manning. He comes up over him because Manning cannot afford to pick up his fourth personal foul. They get inside the Magic 10.
Gotta go to Manning this time. Take a little time off the clock. Let the big guy handle it. There he is.
Snobby.
Off his foot.
That's the first foul on Abdel Nabi, who came over to the corner.
And Brent, if you're Danny Manning, you've got to be careful not to try to take the whole game over at this point. Keep the pressure on Duke.
Quebec watching Harris. The rotation to Newman, the three, and Newton misses. Rebound by Duke. It was Quebec wrapping it up.
Defensive technique in football. Third leading tackler on that Kansas team, and did a great job moving those feet.
Perry returning. Piper also back in for Kansas. On the floor for the Jayhawks right now, Newton and Pritchard, along with Piper, Berry, and Manning. And for Duke, it is Bricky, Henderson, Berry, Kubek, and Snyder. Piper trying to get it to Manning, finally does, and that soft jump hook. Kubek's three.
Second one for the freshman today, and Duke has not been able to get the three-point shot off.
10:20 to go. Duke now closes to within seven.
Berry can't afford to foul that far out. Duke's making the passing lanes tough.
Bricky fronts Manning. Pritchard off the dribble has it knocked away. Kansas ball. 17 left on the shot clock. King returns for Krzyzewski. And Snyder sits down. It has been a struggle for the Duke point guard here this afternoon. He also jammed a finger. Piper takes the inbound pass. The lob for Manning. Couldn't handle it. Into the hands of Bricky. Henderson into King's hands. Kubek, who's hit those two threes out high.
Berry's trying to post Piper up, get the lob over his head.
Henderson with a jump shot from the baseline. Hit by Kansas. Perry was in rebounding with the big fellas that time for Larry Brown.
Good job by Bricky to keep that ball alive on the offensive board.
Best surge by Duke all afternoon. Kubek's three. Short this time. Perry with an offensive rebound. Fouled by Perry.
Brent, now maybe Kansas can get their second win. We know they don't have a deep bench. You pointed out early in the game, six players are off this squad since the beginning of the year. Makes it tough on Larry Brown, and right now, it's a war of attrition.
Snyder returning for Duke, and Normore will check in for Kansas.
A little delay helps Kansas a little bit. Danny Manning being able to get his breath.
So here so far, Duke's run is over the last 5 minutes. Manning and Newton have carried the offensive load for the Jayhawks. Billy King still looking for his first basket and playing now with four personal fouls, trying to contain Newton. Gets the ball on the inbound pass. There's his first field goal.
Nice pass by Ferry. Almost had to be perfect.
Richard saves it. Manning into the deep corner. Ricky would love to keep him there. Normore spins in the key. Knocked away. Another turnover. Outlet. Here comes King racing Piper. Offensive rebound by Strickland and a foul. No basket.
And even though Duke will go to the line again, they don't convert on the fast break. Now Duke should try to get on that foul line, Brent, right away so that they don't allow Kansas to rest. Force that referee to put the ball in play.
Deep pass to Bricky. Now it's Strickland going baseline. Partially blocked. No foul called. Piper winds up with it for Kansas. And now Danny Manning gives it up to Pritchard. 8:45 to go. 51-46. Kansas over Duke. Manning roaming all over the floor. Here's Piper. Ferry coming out with him. Kansas works the shot clock inside of 15 seconds. Manning misses. Ferry wraps it up.
Smart play by Duke to slow things down, make sure they get the good shot.
Cross to Strickland, the three. Big moment for Duke, and it wouldn't stay down. Now the Jayhawks are back. Crowd coming to its feet here in the Kemper. Newton behind his back. Piper.
Games are matters of inches, aren't they, Brent? You rim out on the three-pointer, and then you get the ball on the almost a steal, not quite.
Wanted Ferry, knocked away by Piper, out of bounds.
Ferry fouled and got away with one. Piper again, who statistically hasn't had a big game, has been sensational with his floor play.
Abdel Nabi checking in for Krzyzewski. 7 minutes and 28 seconds to go as Harris returns for Coach Brown. 53-46, Kansas leading Duke. They have led the entire game. Piper six. Very fine Snyder, who gets inside on the penetration. Manning can't get control. Ferry jumps in, and the possession arrow pointing in favor of
Duke University. Going to get the ball down on the inside. That was a good rebound by Danny Ferry and a good reach in by Quinn Snyder. He's very good at that after a man gets the rebound against him. Okay. Then both teams wearing down a little bit, Brent. They're having a hard time with their shooting touch in this stretch.
Newton paying close attention to Kubek, who's hit the two threes here this half. Off the fake. Misfiring. Run down by Ferry. Danny misses. Push off Nabi, and there was a push underneath, and that's why Abdel Nabi was wide open.
Well, Brent, with 7 minutes to go, if you're Duke University, you've made the good run here. You're down seven. They're too anxious to try to cut it down quickly. Ferry took a bad shot. Kubek tried to force a shot that wasn't there. Really helping Kansas.
Pritchard brings it up. Snyder standing at the timeline. Knocked away by Abdel Nabi. Manning goes for the loose ball, and it is tied up again, and it's Kansas possession.
Remember in that first Duke Kansas game, that ball that went out of bounds, Danny Manning made the great dive for the ball. Now Manning's just trying to use up a little time, get a breath. Fred, you notice the change in the crowd? When the team started out, it seemed like it was a Kansas crowd. As this game has moved along, it seems like the Duke people have gotten a little bit more boisterous.
King returning. I think the Arizona and Oklahoma fans might have started cheering for Duke because they want a close game. A little action before Oklahoma and Arizona move center stage. Deep to Newton on the inbound. Out to Pritchard. Penetrates. There were two Jayhawks. Piper runs it down loose. And here is Manning. Ricky tracking him. Shipping the pass, and the turnover is the 17th of the game against the Jayhawks.
What you see the Jayhawks doing right now is they're looking so much to get the ball to Manning and Melton that they have not had an opportunity, to Newton, they haven't had an opportunity to get anybody else in the offense. They need that third score right now. It may have to be Pritchard.
Now Newton will sit down as Harris comes into the game. And also off that Kansas bench for the first time today is Lincoln Miner, the 6'3 junior out of Houston. And Barry, after shipping that ball out of bounds, will sit down on the Kansas bench. So it's Henderson coming up now for the Blue Devils. They trail at 53-46, 6:20 to go. Ricky. Offensive foul.
And how about Piper? Brent, what is it? Has he scored today? Maybe 2 points?
He has scored eight, Billy. He
eight?
Scored
oh,
six
well,
in the first
that's
half.
That's a quiet eight, then, because I haven't seen a guy play a better defensive game. Of course, that's what he's known for in the Big Eight. Speaking of the Big Eight, what a year this conference has had. Two teams in the Final Four. Great season all the way around.
Miner comes out to the top. Pritchard ships it in now to Manning on that turnaround. That's 23 points
for All-American Danny Manning.
That may be his best shot, that little turnaround jumper from that area. Back to nine.
Piper leaning in, going to the glass that time. He has scored 14 for the game. He's hit 6 of 17 here this afternoon. Richard's lob winds up in you-know-who, Manning to the glass. Coming off it's Berry. Here now, it's 3-on-2. Henderson wraps it to Kubek. Offensive foul.
Well, Brent, that all about even it up, because I thought we had a charge before, and under no way that was an offensive foul. Great pass. See, Pritchett's not even close to being in position. He actually is the one that made the contact. That'll even it up.
Coach K is still yelling out at Booker about that charge call. Scoreboard stays at 55-48 with 5:15 to go.
Snyder's rested. He's been on the bench. What a fabulous job by Pritchett today. The stamina he showed to handle that ball so much.
Manning pops out high. Piper bringing it along with Ferry. King trapped him, but Ferry runs down the loose ball. Manning, Ricky watching him, goes to the floor, and they turn it over on the pass, and here's Strickland. Duke trailing by 4:30 mark. They were once down by 18 in the first half of this game.
Surprised Snyder's not picking Pritchard up full court, making him give up the ball some.
Another steal by Duke. Here's Ferry.
Brown's got to go timeout here, Brent. His club is exhausted. I would imagine when they get up over half court, he'll call it.
Duke pressuring them meanwhile.
He's not using one. It surprises me.
And inside of four they go. The closest we've been since the early moments of the game. Down to three.
trying to set up Manning one-on-one down low. No help down there.
Here's Pritchard in low.
Oh, there he hits it.
Oh, what a shot.
Now it's Snyder wanted it, and Manning stepped in and intercepted the pass.
Now, you notice what Mike Krzyzewski put Billy King on Pritchett. Change here. Kansas goes to an open offense. Nobody in the low post now, looking for those back screens, backdoor cuts.
Perry looking for something on the inside. Nothing there. So he'll come back out now to Pritchett. Harris from the baseline gets inside. Great play by Strickland on the block. Duke's ball. This has turned out to be a magnificent game as Duke claws its way back into this national semifinal. Kansas still ahead by five. In case the ball is tied up. Now, one of the things that has turned around this half are the turnovers. Kansas has turned it over this half 11 times and Duke only 7. Duke for the game turned it over 15 times already.
A fresh Newton back in the game, Brent. That's going to help Kansas in that open offense. He can score down low. Looking for a three here.
Snyder with the two. No. Booker signals it as a two. He was close to the line.
They move Snyder back on Pritchett. That's because Newton came back in the game. Good cut.
Pritchard's open. Manning follows. 25 for Manning.
Got to be thinking three-point play here. Strickland trying to get open.
Behind the back to Bricky. And there's a blocking foul underneath. It goes against Perry. That's his third personal foul.
And I'm surprised that Duke is going inside now. You'd like to set up the three-point play, try to get it back down to two.
Billy, don't you think it's early?
No, I don't think you're talking about desperation three. I'm talking about penetration, back out, hit the three. You got Strickland. Snyder can shoot it out there. Then yeah. Rebound strong.
But the only threes hit here by Duke in this game have both been scored by the freshman Kubek. They're 2 of 7 out there in this game.
Well, I can assure you that in the next game there will be more than 2 for 7 of 3 points when you put Oklahoma on this floor.
They'll shoot 7 in the first minute and a half. The other in Kansas is 2 of 5 from the threes. Ricky couldn't get it to roll, and Newton all over that rebound. Now the Jayhawks come down, up by 4 at 153.
See the open offense, they're cutting behind Duke. And the overplay, you got to be careful here.
Manning coming way out and down away from the ball. Danny Perry commits his fourth personal foul.
Piper, a 68% free throw shooter. How often do we see it in these tournament games? It goes down to those free throws. You can just put the nails in the coffin or let a game slip away from you.
Danny trying to explain that he was giving ground there to Piper, who steps up to the free throw line with his 8 points. He's been perfect in his 2 free throws so far. And he runs it to 3.
Young man's had a great game. Interesting thing, he went to Lawrence, Kansas High School. His team won the state crown before Danny Manning got there. Danny Manning's senior year, they did not win it.
4 of 4 and a big game for Piper. It goes back to a 6-point lead now, inside of 140.
Good job by Barry, not giving the three.
There's Snyder's three. Again, they miss. Kansas drops the ball out of bounds as 2 players go for the rebound that time.
Mike Krzyzewski calls for his team to run the 1-4 offense. Now he knows with 2 possessions, he's got to go ahead and get those threes up.
Danny Manning, did you see that blood on his, I believe it was his right leg?
I can assure you he doesn't feel a thing.
Not giving Brookie anything on the inside.
Oh, nice
yanked it away. Berry again tries to draw the foul and could not, as Berry gives it to Newton.
Nope.
No basket.
And there's a case where Scooter Berry made a mental mistake. When you've got that kind of a break, what you're trying to do now is use clock. With a minute and 12 to go and a six-point lead, bring the ball back out and let you have an absolute layup. A good physical play, but not a good mental play.
Shooting 1-1 as Snyder confers with Krzyzewski. And still to come here this evening, we'll have the second game. A couple of number one seeds will be squaring off. Arizona, which stormed out of the West, to take on the Sooners of Oklahoma, the team which dominated everyone in the Southeast region of this NCAA tournament. King bangs a free throw at the front end of the 1-1, a big moment for Duke.
Billy King, a notoriously poor free throw shooter.
As Danny Ferry kidded him yesterday, the 3.5-year slump is over. But he missed that one. And Newton puts it into Berry's hands, and Snyder goes over and quickly commits the foul.
Well, the son of one of the great free throw shooters in the history of the game has a chance to seal some things here. You want to put Newton on the foul line if you're Duke. He's the poorest free throw shooter, only at 56%. Is that the end for Billy King? No.
King with four, sitting out right now, and Ferry with four.
What I think we're seeing Mike Krzyzewski doing here is that little defensive substitution. He brings Kubek back in, so he's got 3 3-point shooters out there.
Coming down toward the 1 minute mark. Snyder gets it back. Strickland looking for the three. Not there. Rebound by Kansas. And now they're closing in on an appointment to play for the championship. Here's Newton. Foul by Snyder as he came underneath him and committed his third. Like a professor, but Larry Brown can scream with the Bob Knights of the world.
You know, it's incredible, Grant, not only in the college game, but in the NBA and in the ABA as a coach. He never had a team that didn't make it to the playoffs, and here he is three times in the 80s in the Final Four with a chance to take two teams to the championship game. There's the man to foul. Well, what a game he's had, huh?
Billy, that's 20 points with 7 rebounds.
Kubek trying to find the three.
Ferry fires up the three. Runs it down here. Time running out on the Blue Devils. He comes back again. Wouldn't stay down. Yanked away by Manning. Wanted Newton again. Pritchard goes after it along with Bricky. And Duke comes back. Three, missing again, and Kansas is going to play for the championship. Quickly comes down now for the Blue Devils. Snyder into the hands of Bricky, rejected by Manning, who has had a monster of an afternoon. 25 points, 10 rebounds, 7 block shots now, and 4 steals. The player of the year has simply done it all here this afternoon. And how proud is this man over
on the Kansas bench.
Trent, you know, there was an awful lot of criticism of Larry Brown when he gave the job to Ed Manning. People said the only reason Ed's getting the job is because of Danny. But Ed Manning was a great leader when he was with the Carolina Cougars, did a great job at North Carolina A&T, and it was very unfair criticism of Ed, who's done a tremendous job as an assistant. And this man right here, Johnny Orr, told me something this morning. He said the two greatest players he ever coached against were Danny Manning and Magic Johnson. Some compliment.
And the big fella leaves to a standing ovation. He has not yet played his last college game. Ferry puts in a three-point shot. Just two ticks of the clock left. You know, back in 1957, Kansas came to the championship game right here in Kansas City, and it wound up being an all-time classic. North Carolina needed three overtime to get past Wilt Chamberlain and Kansas. Now the Jayhawks will come back to a title game only 45 minutes away from their campus.
Well, another great big man, Clyde Lavelleta, will be going into the Hall of Fame this year. He led his club to a national championship right here in the city.
We'll come back for the Kansas celebration when we continue in a moment. And they have never been headed, although the Blue Devils made a great rally here in the second half. They were unable to get the job done. Kansas Jayhawks will play for a national championship.